Book number two is looking at the question of what exists from the point of view of matter. In other words, it concentrates its observations on the basis of our physical experience. Matter, which is characterized by mass, is exactly the type of transformation that the energy is creating on our own space-time continuum. Matter is integral from the point of view of its existence with notions such as gravity that science itself does not know what it is. Yet we live with that and we see its effect continuously. It's interesting because the title of the book is actually a question. The question is, our senses, are they a window or a blindfold to reality? So it opens up a discussion on the basis of which the reader is introduced to several dilemmas and he or she has to make a decision to what extent the particular line of thinking is objective or it has assumed objectivity. In other words, subjective. The subtitle of this book is also very revealing and relates to extrasensory perception. And it includes the phrase extrasensory perception, necessary requirement to appreciate reality. So obviously, the book number two that deals with matter, it is preoccupied about the results of matter itself. And it gives an opportunity to us to examine the result and the limitations of our senses, as well as to see the effect and the extent of the phenomena of extrasensory perception. As a matter of fact, in book number two, we'll be dealing with the very important questions of space, time, and shape. Qualities that we recognize through our physicality, but metaphysically are very questionable. As a matter of fact, after going through the book, you will have good reasons to understand that the notions of space, time, and shape are simply results of the limitations of our senses and in reality do not even exist. A great part of the second book will deal with the phenomena of extrasensory perception. And over half of the book is dealing with these phenomena, which are very important. Why they are so important? As already has been mentioned, the phenomena of extrasensory perception, once they are recognized, they can give us valuable information that can enrich our sense of reality, help us to reach to a certain level of extended reality, and therefore understand much better what we are and what exists around us. A couple of points I'll make only about the phenomena of extrasensory perception. All the phenomena of extrasensory perception are united into one particular phenomenon. And that phenomenon relates to out-of-body experience. For any probability of getting the most out of a phenomenon of extrasensory perception, you have to leave your body temporarily, even for a short time. How many times while you are daydreaming somebody is touching your shoulder and you react like, what, why did that happen? Because you were forced to come back as soon as possible. That simple observation alone shows that the particular extrasensory perception phenomenon was the result of an astral projection, out-of-body experience. There are two fundamental types of projections. One is of out-of-body experience. One is astral, the other is mental. In the astral, you abandon your body. So you have to come back as soon as possible. You are returning from the astral world to the physical world in a split of a second. After all, there's no time. Time is an illusion. So once you are awakened or you are touched by somebody so that your sense of security is energized, you are automatically returning back to your physical body, which results into this reaction. Okay. On the other hand, mental projections are different. Mental projections is a trip. You leave your physical body and you go up there and you are roaming freely into the mental component. Okay? So it's still an out-of-body experience, but it is of a cognitive format. Whereas from the physical body, if you go to the astral body, you do not abandon 100% your body. A component of your consciousness is still there. But most of you are going to the other, to your double, to your astral component. And you are manning this part. You are giving, you are focusing there instead of there. Therefore, you have to come back. Reverse when there is the type experiencing modification. Okay, so these two types, the astral projection and the mental projection, are behind every and each one of the phenomena of extrasensory perception. You will get a very clear understanding about these things into book number 2. Also, there will be a whole chapter that will deal with the phenomenon of extrasensory perception, which is known as aura. Aura viewing is a very important extrasensory perception phenomenon. And its importance lies on the fact that it is the only phenomenon that we can replicate using photographic techniques. Therefore, it becomes a candidate of proving to people that the extrasensory perception phenomena exist. As we said, the phenomenon of aura viewing or aura photography is of extreme importance because it can be replicated using mechanical means. But we have to keep in mind what an aura photography is all about. It is the part of our auric field to the extent the available technology allow us to be photographed and replicated in some form. You notice the wording is very, very careful. In some form, to the extent we can, I imply there that aura photography is still very crude. But nevertheless, it is the first phenomenon of extrasensory perception that we can capture. And by doing that, we have the opportunity to convince ourselves that ESP exists. That's for the people who are critically inclined towards this kind of thinking, and I was one of them. Very, very critical. But not with closed mind. So I saw the truth very fast. It was within me, so it surfaced right away. But it's healthy to be critical. And I advocate to each one of us, when he's going through this his inquiries, to keep his filters on. Because there is a lot that can affect us, and all of it is understood in a subjective manner, is not objective, therefore you have to be capable of distinguishing the sources and the impact on you. Keep that in mind. Towards the end of book number two, we'll also be talking about the universal laws. The universal, or if you wish, cosmic laws, are the laws that apply to the whole creation. And there are only two. People are creating all kinds of laws. In reality, these laws are corollaries of the two laws. They are just logical consequences of what the two laws prevail. Okay? But if you want to really talk about cosmic laws, there are only two. One of them is the cosmic law of free will. It is the most important gift of God to its creations. It's what makes the creations to be God-like. It's the fact that they can do what they have in mind to make their own decisions and take the responsibility for that. Very powerful. There is cost involved in everything. So you have to be capable of taking the responsibility. And there is no way not to choose. You will have to choose while you are experiencing the various scenario that you have led yourself into while you are living. You have to choose. And your choice will have always certain benefit and certain cost involved. Nevertheless, the cosmic law of free will is static. It's up to you. You cannot impose on others. No, you cannot impose on others. But you can prevail in their thinking, and therefore you can affect the others according to what you want to do. If they accept you the way you present yourself, they are exercising their free will and they play along with you. If they do not accept you, then you have to find some other way to go about it. And then you suffer cost because you impose on them. Anyway, the cosmic law of free will is a static law of most importance. Then there is another one, which is very dynamic. It's the cosmic law of like attracts alike. This is one of the least understood principles of the creation. It has many names. Its most usual name is the law of karma. Sometimes people call it divine justice. Sometimes people think of it as as God's effort to punish you for something you did. Nothing to do with the reality. The reality is that when you are making a choice on the basis of your own preference, you are affecting the dynamic situation of the different factors that they co-create during the actual execution of a specific scenario. And by affecting that, you are creating all kinds of friction, if you wish. You are creating all kinds of dynamic pros and cons for you and everybody that you are co-creating with. And that it is translating into repercussions. In other words, God does not punish you. You punish yourself. You put yourself in the hole. And you close the lid as well. Okay? So, having said that, the like attracts a like cosmic law is not abstract that much. It is it's blatant. It's blatant. Because you want to do good, you will be helped by good entities. You want to do bad, who is going to help you? Bad entities. You pay a ticket for that. You owe them. Okay? And they will come for the liter of blood. That's how it works. If you try to do good, they help you. You get nothing because of that, but you get the benefit of having done good. So, no imposition there. So, what I'm trying to say is that these two laws, they are the foundation of all the of God's thinking, because it seems, according to my understanding, that the Supreme Creational Force said, okay, I allow you to express yourself responsibly and you are accountable to me through the like attracts alike law. Okay? Then you go ahead and you do what you think you are going to do. You play the game, okay? Then who is going to help you for that? Who is going to not help you? Who is going to tolerate you? Who is going to accept you? And who is going to fight you for that? That's another story. Keep in mind that the higher is the quality of a spiritual entity, the less will be assisting you, me, or anybody else to impose on others. If you are looking after number one, don't expect any advanced entity to help you. They will let you on your own. But there will be other kinds of entities that will rush to help you. But these entities are doing it for their own sake. Therefore, you're going to pay for that. So that's book number two. It's talking about matter, extrasensory perception, and reaches to a certain point that deals with the universal laws. Thank you.